So I'll have this recording to send out to everybody after the meeting. So, you know, if you have anything you want to go over again, you will have a recording. Okay. So, hi, Scott. How are you? Nice to see you again.
Thanks, Alice. It's great to be here. And thanks to you and Lisa and everyone at the Cultural Alliance of Western CT for hosting us today. I know I've met several of you before. I see some familiar faces and names here. Possibly not all of you. There's some names that look a little bit new. So I'm glad to be meeting you today as well. And I know we've talked most recently a lot about the CT Cultural Fund and the operating support grants. Many of you have for arts, history, cultural heritage organizations across the state. And we'll get into a little bit about that as well, but we haven't had as much time to talk to you about some of the other grant lines that we offer at Connecticut Humanities. And that's what Lian and I really want to focus on today. So I'm going to start by sharing my screen and get us to Connecticut Humanities website. So give me one second here. As long as I click the right buttons, we're going to be fine. All right, here we go. All right, so if everyone can see my screen, we're going to be kind of taking you through a couple different areas of cthumanities.org, the website for Connecticut Humanities, and Lian and I are going to be tag teaming the presentation. So again, I'm Scott, I'm the Director of Grants and Programs at Connecticut Humanities. Lian is the Grants Assistant at Connecticut Humanities, and we are the state affiliate of the National Endowment for the Humanities. So we are kind of the sibling organization to the Office of the Arts, and we do the work at the state level that the National Endowment for the Humanities does at the federal level, like the Office of the Arts does at the state level for the National Endowment for the Arts. We have had a granting program for many years, and the granting program has expanded to support organizations through the pandemic in ways that we've talked about before, and we'll talk a little bit more again about today. But by and large, when going to our website, all the stuff you're going to be looking for is under the grants top header here. And we've got a left side and a right side to our navigation. The left side has information about our granting program overall, and the right side has the different grant lines that are open currently, or you can get to some of the past grant lines as well. We're going to take you through the about to begin with, and I'll hand it over to Lian in a second here, because we've been doing a lot of work to update our grant pages to make it even easier and more helpful to you all, especially with new organizations finding us, to let you know about the opportunities that we have and make it simple to go where the right place is on our site for the funding that you're after. So we'll talk about the about and the different grant lines we have. We'll take you through the grant application process. We do not try to work behind smoke and mirrors. We try to be upfront about how our whole process works. And we'll take you through from an initial inquiry to if you get a grant all the way through closing out. Talk a little bit about our funding priorities and then highlight a little bit of the grant lines here before stopping to answer some questions. But as I go to the About CTH Grants page, you can see, you know, we've been granting out with state money since the 1990s. But we have been granting through other funds from the federal level going back even earlier than that. For the longest time, our grants were all project-based and for organizations doing humanities projects. And we'll get more into what those are. But by and large, if you are an organization that wants to help us understand who we are as a people, where we've come from as a society, the issues facing us today, what kind of things we might be looking at tomorrow, And you can do that in a variety of ways, from discussion-based programs through exhibits. Those are our core grant lines. And we know it's confusing, so we've created a chart here. And I'm going to pass it over to Lian to kind of take you through the chart and quickly find which grant line is right for you as we delve deeper as we go along here.
All right. Hi, everyone. Like Scott said, my name is Lian. I'm the Grants Assistant at Connecticut Humanities. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the overview of our grants here. So in this chart, you will find the list of all of our project grants, as well as the operating support grant, some sample types of projects, and there's more information on the individual grant pages, but this is kind of a way for you to look quickly to see if there's something that matches up the with the project idea that you have. The next column is the funding amounts, so kind of looking at what is the scope of your project and what might be a good fit. After that is the grant duration. So looking at, again, the scope of your project, if it's something that can be done in 9 months, if it needs 24 months, the matching requirements, the deadlines, and then finally, when is the earliest that you can start your project? So the purpose of this chart is really to help you see, based on the scope of your project and the timeline of your project and what you're thinking about, which is the grant that probably would be the best fit for you, so that you can take a closer look at that specific grant and see if that's something that would fit your needs. At the very top, you'll also see that there was a link to download it as a PDF. So especially if you're looking on your phone, that's probably the best way to look at this. Or if you wanted to print it out, you could do it there as well. As Scott was pointing out, at the very bottom of this chart, we also have the operating support grants. And like he mentioned before, the operating support grants are the grants that are for general operating support for humanities, arts, and cultural organizations. So that is the one that is a little different from our traditional project-based grants, which would all be more humanities project-based. And I believe Scott will talk about that in more detail as we look through each of the grants. Then finally, at the bottom of this page, you'll see sponsorships. And sponsorships are something new that were launched just a couple of months ago. And these are very similar to grants, but they have some key differences. You'll see that they don't have a matching requirement, that they go up to $2,000, though you might be able to request for more, and that's something that we can talk about. The real focus of the sponsorships is more about audience size and CTH visibility. So we can talk a little bit more about that as well, but that's one way in which it differs from a grant. And then one key thing to note is under earliest start date for the project, you'll see that it's 2 months after the deadline. This is the only one that has a 2 month wait period. And that's because one of the key purposes of a sponsorship is in exchange for CTH visibility. So we need to provide some time to allow for marketing and for that visibility.
So we'll get a little bit more into each one of these, but I want to, before doing that, highlight one other thing here. So under the grants again on the left, we can see our grant application process. And I kind of want to walk us through that, because a lot of people are often confused as to how to start a conversation, when to get in touch with Connecticut Humanities, and what happens at different stages. So Lian, I'll turn this over to you again, because this was another one of the great pages that you created for us.
Sure. Yeah, so at the very top, you'll see that on this page, you will find this is a navigation tool, so you can jump to what is most, what information you're looking for. So the very first section is on the submission, the application submission process. And this primarily relates to our core project grants. So that would be the quick grants, planning, implementation, and capacity grants that we will talk a little bit more about. But this is really the application process for those grants. On the right, you'll see a graphic. And if you click on the graphic, it creates a PDF that you can download or you can print, whatever is easiest for you. And this takes you through from your initial idea all the way through to submitting your application. So we require that you reach out to grant staff, me or Scott, to talk about your project idea. And the purpose of doing this is to make sure that we're matching you up to the right grant line so that we can set you up for the most success. We just wouldn't want you to start an application if it's a project that probably would not be successful in that grant line. We hope that you'll be able to reach out to us with a couple of weeks before the deadline. And the purpose of that is that we would like to set up a grant consultation. And that's a meeting with either myself, Scott, or sometimes both of us, where we can talk with you about your project and about the grant application. And we can answer any questions that you might have about the application or the budget. It's also a good time for us to talk about what we think might be something to highlight for the application review committee, or if there's any information that we think would be helpful to add to the application. So that's ideal for before you start your drafting your application. After that, you'll draft your application. And the next step is strongly recommended, where we hope that you'll be able to email us about 2 weeks out from the deadline with a draft for a draft review. Scott and I offer draft reviews, so we will read through your draft and provide some comments, looking for things like making sure that your budget meets all of the requirements, making sure that there's no key information missing, if there's any areas where we think it's not particularly clear, or maybe there's something that you brought up in your grant consultation that we thought was really great and is missing there, that's kind of a place where we can kind of connect those dots. So we will do a draft review for you, and then you can edit your draft and submit your application. Once you've submitted your application will go to the application review process. So that's the next section that's highlighted here. And we won't go through all of this since you can read it from the website, but basically some things to highlight are that the applications are reviewed by a review committee. So Scott and I do not review applications, but you can see here all of these with the little plus sign. You can click on those, they're drop-down menus, and they give you more information about what your application is being reviewed on. So that's something that you might want to look at if you're concerned about how you're being assessed. So once your application has gone through the review committee process, the committee makes some award recommendations to the CTH board. And after the board has voted on those decisions, that's when Scott or I will provide you with a notification of whether you received the award or not.
And we always will contact you both via an email award notification. We don't do mail notifications anymore, but we also call you whether you got the grant or not. And the calls are much more fun when you get the grant. But even when you don't get the grant, we want this to not be a door closing to a relationship with us. We want it to be the opportunity to provide feedback and to get you to success on the next application that you submit.
So the last section that we have here is about what happens if your grant application is approved and what happens if it's denied. If it's approved, you'll go through the grant management process. And again, here you can click on that if you would like that as a PDF. And I'm not going to go through this, but this is also something that once you receive the grant that we will convey to you on the phone and through email as well. And there's also more information on the specific grant line web pages. So this is just kind of an overview of what the grant management process will look like. But when you get to that stage, we will certainly be reminding you of it as well. And then what happens if your grant application is denied? We will reach out to you, as Scott said, via phone and or email and convey to you the reasons that the application was denied. And if the committee feels that there is the possibility that your grant would be or that your application would be accepted with some revisions, we'll work with you on making those revisions for the next deadline. So that's kind of the whole process going all the way from your idea all the way to getting the grant and closing out the grant all on this one page.
Thanks, Lian. And we hope that this is helpful and appreciated, but it's just a nice way now of hopefully demystifying a process which we've never intended to be mystical, but hopefully it's a little bit more straightforward and happy to answer any questions that you have. But before we do that, let's highlight some of the grants here, because I know that's when the reason many of you are on the calls. What other things do we fund? So again, hovering over here, you can see a lot of the different grant lines that Lian is talking about and a couple other ones that are some shorter term and some longer term new projects for us as well. Quick grants is the one I want to highlight first. These are smaller project grants, under $5,000, offered every other month and have minimal match requirements. You still need a one-to-one match, but you don't need to do any fundraising to get these grants. If you click on all of our grant pages now, you'll see some similarities to the format that Lian was just talking about. There's jump navigation at the top of the page to quickly figure out, do I have an overview of the program or do you want to get to the frequently asked questions? For the overview, we have a chart here that helps us talk about the kind of things that Quick Grants fund. In this case, programs that are to the general public, free or low cost to attend, interpretive and based on the humanities. We get a lot of questions about what the humanities are. So we've got some explanation here about, you know, these are the fields of study that help us understand who we are as a people, like we talked about. And there's a more complete definition of the humanities that you can visit. Some of the fields of study like literature or art history. And then what's the difference between the arts, the humanities, and STEM? So by and large, Quick Grants help support the contextualization of things like a performance or an exhibit of art. We help us understand the impact of STEM on our history, on our culture, and our values and our beliefs. So whereas we wouldn't fund a concert outright if the number one goal and all that happens is to hear a piece of music and have people go home having enjoyed a performance, we could start to get into funding a concert that includes before, throughout, or after a discussion of the impact of that music and its era on us as a society. And we can help answer more specific questions when they pop up. We know it can be confusing. So we've added some sample quick grants here now. And you can see model sample grants for discussion-based programs, exhibits, tours, digital learning tools, community reading projects, the different types of quick grants that we fund with a description more about what is a discussion-based program. It's an opportunity, whether it be through film screenings or concerts or performances or lecture series, to really get into discussions that engage with the audience about your topic. And we've got a variety of model talks here from a variety of different types of organizations, a history author talk, a historical society series of programs with discussion about the suffrage centennial, which just happened a few years ago, or an arts organization doing an exhibit, but also having a lot of discussions about aging and health, happiness, and the impact of aging on us as a society. If you have a larger grant than this, we will be starting to pick up some of our other grant lines, like implementation grants. So we'll talk about those in a moment. But for quick grants and all the other ones you can get for guidelines and application, a quick look at what our guidelines are for the program, a reiteration of what the funding priorities are that speak to this specific grant line, and then the dates for that grant line. And for quick grants, like I said, it's every other month. So we actually have a June one coming up in 2 days. If you are planning on submitting a grant for that and you've not talked to us, please do so very quickly so we can help give you guidance. Because again, the number one thing is we want to make sure that no one is getting frustrated and time is not being spent in vain. Lian and I, as she said, don't make the decisions. We're like that tennis official where we're trying to create the best field of play and have everyone leave satisfied at the end of the match, no matter the result. Quick grants have a quick turnaround. So those June grants, people will know their status by the end of June, and project work can start beginning in July. And there's a 9-month window of activities for all the quick grants. Won't talk about all this, but we do have a lot of frequently asked questions, which get into the things that we're asked most often about the matching funds. And again, this is for quick grants. You have to meet a minimum one-to-one match, but you can do that all in time, paid or unpaid time. And if you've got a lot of volunteers that are working on a project and contributing hours and you value that time and track it, you can get money to run all the hard costs of your program with just the time that people are putting in for a quick grant. And then we have some resources if you get the grant at the end of all these pages, things like the checklist of things to be doing, our PR toolkits for that specific grant line, and ways to contact and thank your legislators. Where quick grants leave off, implementation grants take over. These run from $5,000 up to $35,000. They fund, by and large, the same types of projects, but because the grant dollar amounts go up, the matching requirements do change. So we'll highlight here in the frequently asked questions when it comes to the matches, you do need to start having external cash as at least a percentage of the minimum match for that grant line. So if you ask for a $24,000 grant, you need at least a quarter or $6,000 of your minimal match to be from outside funds. Once you hit $25,000, it jumps to 50%, and then you start needing $12,500. So we get a lot more $24,000 requests than we do $26,000 requests. But if you have a larger project, this can go up to $35,000. Won't go over all the things we've said, but we do have samples of those grants, which include attachments. The quick grants, really, by and large, your grant is just you telling us your story and giving us the budget for that project. At the implementation stage, we start needing things like illustrations of the objects or images that you'll include in an exhibit, sample text of labels, a floor plan for the exhibit, and similar types of other attachments at the other project types as well. These grants are offered twice a year, in April and in November, and they have roughly a quarter, in some cases a little bit less of a turnaround. So those April grants that came in 2 months ago now are still making their way through our process, will be voted on by our board at the upcoming June board meeting. Notification will happen by the end of June, and those April grants will begin project work in July and have at least a two-year window. You can use less of that time, but we give you 2 years to do the work. If you're not ready to do that, we've got a grant to help you get ready. And that's where the planning grants come in. So this is not a doing grant. This is a grant to really help you do scholarly research, travel, get feedback from the communities you're working with, and make all those necessary plans and preparations to develop and finalize and create a project that could become a quick grant or could become an implementation grant. A planning grant is not required to get implementation grant, nor does it guarantee implementation funding, but the kind of work that you would do at the planning stage is what you're going to need to share with us at an implementation grant to be successful. And we could use this grant line to help you get there if you're not ready on your own. We've got, again, samples of the types of projects that we fund for discussion-based programs. You know, a lot of PSLAs just really jump into the doing for them, but Fairfield Museum had a successful planning grant to really do all kinds of exhibit planning and program planning for an exhibit on speaking up and looking at the electoral system a few years ago. The same dates, April and November, as implementation grants, same notification window, and a grant period that lasts a maximum of 18 months. The last of the core grant lines for us is capacity grants. This is a little bit different in that these grants are not project-based and about the work you're doing for the public, but about how we can strengthen organizations that do humanities work so that they can do more, better, stronger humanities projects in the future. And this is often consultant-led stuff that will happen behind the scenes, like strategic planning or board training, doing audience assessments and surveys, work with IDEA to be more equitable and accessible, and train your staff or your board, or do assessments of the operations you have. And you can see the full list of projects that we have here. Again, sample capacity grants in a variety of these different types. And the dates for this are on the same timeline as planning and implementation, April 1 and November 4th. Planning grants go up to $25,000. Capacity grants max out at $10,000. You're allowed to have one quick grant, one planning or implementation, one capacity grant. And if you have operating support, that's a whole separate thing, an operating support grant as well. So if you have operating support, you're not locked out of any of these other grant lines. You're just not allowed to have two capacity grants simultaneously. You got to close out the first to get to the second. We'll just say a little bit about the cultural funds. I know many of you have been on these calls with us before. Again, we're very fortunate that the state has made available $16 million of operating support for the year we're currently in, and we made 632 awards, which you can see with the full list of awards here. Won't go a lot more into year one other than to say these grants are coming again. There is a year two of funding. It's roughly half of the funding that we had in year one. So we're going to be granting out in the neighborhood of $8 million this coming fiscal year. Fiscal year 23 operating support grants will go live in August with a deadline of November 4th with notification before Christmas for project work using those funds in calendar year 2023. Some more to come about operating support. If you got operating support in year one, by and large, if you know, you were eligible in year one, you will be eligible in year two, but more to come. And then I think that's it, because I think some are at the museum sponsorships, last thing is sponsorships. So sponsorships, as Lian said, are slightly different, and it's our newest grant line. These are not as much about all the details about your programs that we would be looking for successful other grants. we still have to have humanities projects, and you have to give enough detail that the committee understands the type of project that you're running, but it's more about visibility for us and serving audiences in parts of the state that we don't do through our normal grant making. This is another fast turnaround. We've got every other month deadlines, and basically in the month that we don't have quick grants. So we just had a May deadline, did notification yesterday of all the May award decisions. We'll have another one in July, a 1 month turnaround. As Lian said, the one big difference between quick grants is that we wanna have a space between when you apply and when your activities start to make sure that our branding and credit for support can go on all those activities. The top ask is $2,000, but if you do have a project where you would like to ask for higher sponsorship on a case-by-case basis, we'll allow submissions for that and review those accordingly. That is a lot of information about a lot of the different grant lines, and we tried to do it quickly here and hopefully painlessly, but happy to, if we want to take a break and answer any questions that anyone has about any of our grant lines before turning it over to our friends at the Office of the Arts.
Does anybody have questions that they want to ask? That is a lot of information, but I like that you guys will meet with people, and you can, and anyone can email you or Leanne, Scott or Leanne, for questions regarding if they apply for certain grants.
For sure. I mean, we really require that. Because the one thing we don't want to have happen, I got Howard and then I'll do Nancy next. We don't want frustration. When I came here, I've been here almost 15 years now, people spend a lot of time putting together grants. They really are thoughtfully working on stuff and doing their best. And if you are got a project that it just isn't the right grant line, or it's not the right grant for us, we would love to have that get redirected in the right place before a lot of effort is expended versus the other, because the frustration is going to be there no matter what, but we're going to try to make sure that it's early on with the least amount of effort. And in many cases, you know, the timing might be off, the grant line might be another one, or I might be sending you over to Tamara or someone at the Office of the Arts. And we do a lot of helping redirect people back and forth to ourselves and other organizations. Howard, I know you had a question here.
Yeah, I noted in one of the grant categories you had, I think it was sponsorships, you listed scholarships. And what, you know, like we run programs here at the Craft Center and we offer scholarships to people since, you know, we want to remove any financial barriers, which, you know, we get grants and various people donate money. Is that the same kind of scholarship you're thinking of? Could we apply to you to support that kind of operation?
So we have not had a scholarship grant to us yet since we reopened the sponsorships, but the intent here is it's going to be for humanities projects. And I think we were talking about some requests we've had for programs working with youth to maybe participate in a program like a Model UN or another type of activity there where, or the New England Museum Association, for example, that might want to provide sponsorships and scholarships for Connecticut residents to be able to participate in this program without cost being a factor. So for the students to be able to do a Model UN and learn about other countries and other cultures, or for a professional development conference to be able to allow 10, 15, 20 Connecticut Museum people to be able to attend from the smaller all-volunteer places to get the best, most up-to-date content. Those are the kind of things that were envisioned, and we can talk more offline about specific ideas you have.
But I think that's kind of like one of the programs we're working on right now with City Lights in Bridgeport. And maybe that would qualify and help us underwrite that program.
Sure, happy to discuss that and give guidance, Howard.
Sure, thank you,
Nancy.
Yes, I would like to understand how, like looking at the bigger organizational picture, where CT Humanities fits in with the Council of the Arts?
All right, so we're sibling organizations, basically, is the best way to put it here. So the Office of the Arts, and Liz and Tamara and Rhonda, jump in if I say something that's not quite the way you would say it. They often fund the presentation the performance aspects of things?
I'm already going to jump in.
Okay.
So I think it helps to think of us with, as Scott said, as siblings. The Office of the Arts is a state arts agency. Our statutory partner and funder is the National Endowment for the Arts. Connecticut Humanities is a state humanities organization, state humanities partner. Their funding partner is the National Endowment for the Humanities. So the state of Connecticut matches funding that the Office of the Arts receives from the NEA and matches funding that Connecticut Humanities receives from NEH. And that is a requirement of our federal funding. So in order to get the federal funding, it has to be leveraged by state or potentially private funding. That said, we are both subject to the kind of rules and requirements of our federal agencies who are our funding partners. So for the Office of the Arts in general, the projects that we fund or the operating support that we give can only be for organizations who are spend more than 51% of their budget on arts related activities, and there's lots of definitions that go with that. Connecticut Humanities has a similar operating philosophy, but it is in respect to the humanities, which is really hard to define. And Scott kind of started off by talking about what the humanities are. It's sort of the interpretation of the actions of human life on the world. But that's why we are different.
Right. Okay, thank you. A follow-up question. You said 51% of the grant applicants project has to be art related. Does that apply to the humanities?
So let me just clarify, because that's not exactly right. What I said is the art to be qualified as an arts organization, you must spend at least 51% of your budget on arts, of your operating budget, on arts activities. And you must define yourself as an arts organization, because our grant lines look a little bit different than Connecticut Humanities. They're more along the lines of operating support than projects right now because of the pandemic. And Scott, I'll let you go now.
Yeah, so we are not, by and large, for our humanities only grants, doing operating support. They are all project-based. And where we are right now is it doesn't matter if you're an arts organization, a history organization, or a social service organization. If you are doing an eligible humanities project, that's what matters the most. And then as long as you're an eligible organization, which be any nonprofit, any municipality, any one of the five state recognized tribes, you can apply to us for that humanities project. It's that gray area between what is arts sometimes and what is humanities. So that's why I use that example of like a concert or a play. So Westport Country Playhouse, they do many plays. If they want to just have a staged production, show it and have people go home, that is not something that we would be funding. Where we come in is when they say, we want to do this main stage production about gun violence in America today. And we want to have a whole bunch of programs that have people understand the Second Amendment and what the original framers intended to have. We want to have a conversation on stage with people that are advocating for stronger gun rights and those that are opposing stronger gun rights. And it's going to be an opportunity to understand the issues and the viewpoints. And then it helps round out and strengthen, or have talkbacks with the cast and the playwright to understand the issues that they were doing when they created the play and the emotions that they're conveying through their characters. That gets into the opportunities of the things that we can help support.
Thank you, that helps a lot.
Yay, we helped, Scott. This is very confusing, so don't worry. At some point or another, when the NEA and the NEH were founded, the federal government divorced the arts from the humanities. And because we're just people and the arts and humanities are part of our everyday life and they're all wifty and mushed together, it's really hard for our brains to figure out what this division is. So we struggle with this all the time. All right.
We're about a lot of words, I guess, is a good way to put it. And those words can be on the wall or in conversation, but helping people understand something, leaving something, knowing more about the world than they went in. And when it's about that knowing and learning, it often comes to us.
And of course, that makes life confusing because we all know literature and writing and poetry is all arts, too. So life is confusing and there's lots of overlaps, and neither Scott nor I, nor our staffs believe that this is cut and dried or that it's actually correct, but this is how we have to work right now. And that's one of the reasons we're here today, because over the last 3 years, 4 years now, we've been working together a lot more closely to make sure that support is aligned and we as staffs understand what we're doing, and we can just like figure out how we move forward together to make it less confusing for you. So believe it or not, I think it's less confusing now than it used to be. It's still mighty confusing. Any more questions for Scott? Okay, super. I will start, and we weren't gonna share our website because our website has issues because we're the state. But Tamara is going to share her screen and I'm going to talk for a minute, and then I'm going to turn it over to Tamara, who will talk about grants for artists, and then to Rhonda, who will talk about our regular programs that are operating support for organizations. So I'm going to start though by saying, let's see, is this like, if we could go to the funding, so this is going to be our homepage, and Tamara is going to navigate to funding opportunities and click on that link. And then you're going to see this list of funding opportunities. So I'm going to go back a minute while you're looking at this, but don't read for comprehension. We are the state, and that's another difference between Connecticut Humanities and the Connecticut Office of the Arts. So Connecticut Humanities is a 501c3. Connecticut Office of the Arts is a division within the Department of Economic and Community Development. And for those of you who are just interested, where I'm not going to talk about the other half of my job right now, which is the State Historic Preservation Office, that half of my job also has grants. And I did put a link to those grants up in the chat at the very beginning. And I'm happy to take questions about those offline, and I will get you to the right staff member who can help you. Because we are the state, we have limitations, go figure, on how user-friendly, that's all I could call it, how user-friendly, what images, all those other things, we can make our website. So there's good news. There's bad news and there's good news. The bad news is what you're seeing now we get is not intuitive or even maybe designed for a user, and with a user in mind and user needs. But in good news, we are actually working right now to fix the problem. And in fact, we will have what's going to be called a microsite, which will have all of our information for the Office of the Arts, which will be a little bit divorced from our parent agency, which is Department of Economic and Community Development. And that will come hopefully by the end of the summer. And as Lian and Scott were going through how their grants were laid out, one of the things that occurred to me, because we're trying to align, we're trying to ask the similar questions in our grants, so we are not overtaxing applicants on asking the same questions again and again. We do have the ability to probably set up our grant opportunities in a way that's kind of similar to Connecticut Humanities. And I will pursue that because I think that we have the opportunity right now, the timing is right. And I think that might help you guys better. So not to go down that track, but what I wanted to sort of first say is that unlike Connecticut Humanities, the Office of the Arts has funding available, limited though it may be, for artists as individuals and for arts organizations, nonprofits only for the most part. So I wanted to land there because Connecticut Humanities does not fund individuals. The Office of the Arts is very limited on how it can fund individuals. We can fund individuals through two grant programs that we have. We can fund individuals through our Artists Respond grant program. This year we offered two rounds of that, and Tamara's gonna talk about that. We also can fund artists through our Artist Fellowship program. But I do wanna make this really clear difference. The reason that we don't fund artists more, and if you're an artist, this is I'm sure something that's at the forefront of your mind, is that the NEA does not allow for us to fund artists directly for anything except for project grants. So the Artist Respond grant is a project grant for artists. The Artist Fellowship grant, we do now every other year, and we fund that through the part of our state award, our state funding award, that is not used for matching our NEA award. all state funds that are used for matching our NEA award are subject to the exact same usage requirements as our NEA award. But we have a little bit of money that we can use in ways that are a little bit more discretionary. So why don't I start by now turning it over to Tamara to talk a little bit about our artist grants. And if you go off mute, are there artists in the room here who are interested in these programs? And that will tell us whether Tamara should go quickly or a little bit more slowly. Any artists here?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. You know, you don't want to tell people things that they don't need. So Tamara, I will turn it over to you.
All right, thank you, and hello, everyone. Just to give a quick overview, because I know time is short, but to give you an overview, what we're doing with the Artist Fellowship and the Artist Respond Program is we are alternating these two programs on an annual basis. So we, as Liz mentioned, we ran Artist Respond in our past fiscal year. We were able to award many more grants than we probably would normally be able to award through that program because we were able to supplement the program with ARPA funds. That's the American Rescue Plan Act funds. We were able to award two rounds of funding. So there was a total of 112 artist grants that went out this year for projects, which was amazing. Very exciting to see so many artists, and upwards of $500,000 went into artist projects this past fiscal year. Again, supported primarily through federal funds for relief and recovery purposes. This coming year, we're going to be focusing on the Artist Fellowship Program. So please be on the lookout for the announcement, which will come later in June. Probably towards the end of June is when this application cycle will open. The Artist Fellowship Program is basically general operating support for artists. It will provide funding in either the amount of $3,000 or $5,000. And we also reserve some funding for emerging recognition awards for artists. An artist does not come in requesting a grant amount. You simply come into the application presenting your work, and you share a little bit about the type of work that you plan to create over the next year. The purpose of the grant is to support the creation of new work. And what we do is we include a peer panel review process. So it is artists who are reviewing your applications and making a determination as to who we are able to elevate and provide the recognition and the award status towards. This particular program, just so you're aware, it falls into two categories on our website, both funding opportunities as well as awards and recognition. We do consider the Artist Fellowship Program to be an award-based program. It's not like a specific project-based. You do not outline a project when you are submitting an application to the Artist Fellowship Program. Instead, you're sharing more about your accomplishments as an artist, and you're sharing more about your vision and where you plan to go in the creation of your new work. And therefore, it is considered an award-based program. For those of you who are not artists in the room, but know of other artists, you know, please share more information about this program. It will open at the end of June with a right now tentative deadline for September. And the funding period begins July 1. I also want to bring your attention to the panelist interest survey. If you are interested in serving as a reviewer, a peer reviewer, or if you know of other artists who would be interested in serving as a reviewer for this program, we do have a place where you can submit your information and share a little bit about your past experience and why you would be a good reviewer for this program. And so with that, there's not too much more detail I could go into. I can share a little bit about past recipients. who are noted on our website, our timeline and process, all of this information on our website will be updated, but you can at least access and learn more about the program and how it was administered in the last funding cycle. But all of this information will be updated at the end of the month.
Thanks, Tamara. That's super. So we're gonna move on and talk about our two general operating support pools of funds for arts organizations that are nonprofits. The two pools are the Supporting Arts Grant Program, which we refer to as SAP, and also the Arts Endowment Program. And to talk a little bit more about those two programs, I'm gonna turn it over to my colleague, Rhonda Olisky, who administers both of those programs.
Hi, everybody. My name is Rhonda. I work in the Connecticut Office of the Arts, and I administer our two programs that offer general operating support to arts organizations. I'm going to start with Supporting Arts. Supporting Arts, again, is a program that offers general operating support to arts organizations as well as municipal arts departments. So if the town or the city you live or work in has a municipal art department, that city or town could come into this program. But basically, it's there's a couple additional eligibilities for a municipal arts department, which is on our website. And there is a short list of ineligible entities, but for the most part, it provides arts organizations with much needed, unrestricted general operating support. It is going through a little bit of a change. It's going to be launched very soon. We're finishing up the guidelines. In the past, the awards were based on an organization's budget size. We're shifting away from that and going more towards a formula based on an organization's operating expenses. And that is right in line with how we've been distributing other grant funds, such as general operating support for theaters and performing groups, as well as the Connecticut Cultural Fund. General operating support grants that were offered this past fiscal year. So it's gonna be in line with that, that funding model. And then, however, no organization will receive less than $1,000. So those guidelines will be posted soon. And they're also gonna share information on what that program, what this program is going to look like in fiscal year 24. So we're going through a little change for fiscal year 23, but we're prepping you for fiscal year 24. For this year, every eligible applicant will receive funding. That has been the case in past years. This will be the case in fiscal year 23. However, that's not necessarily going to be the case moving forward in fiscal year 24. We're trying to, it's going to be taking baby steps to be a little bit more competitive. Trying to think of what else. So the guidelines are going to be posted soon. The application deadline is probably going to be the end of July, with the funding period. Tamara, can you click on the page that I may or may not have for the funding period for Supporting Arts? Do you?
I don't think we have that right now.
Darn it. Okay, my apologies. And then before I move on to endowment, does anybody else have questions on Supporting Arts? No? Okay, we'll move on to the endowment.
I had a quick question, Rhonda.
Okay.
First of all, thank you. It's nice to put a face to the name. I mean, we've been communicating through email for the last 8 years.
Isn't that crazy?
When you say you're going to move to a more competitive situation with the supporting arts, do you have any idea what the rubric might be in terms of qualification so that we could also be sure that we're adjusting if necessary?
Yep, and that's what all that information is going to be in the information that we launch for fiscal year 23. So when fiscal year 23 information comes out, it's going to have what you need to start prepping for the future years. I can tell you right now, it's going to be heavily weighted on DEI and accessibility.
And I'll jump in and just say, Howard, just to follow up on what Rhonda said, heavily related on DEI and accessibility, but this is pertaining to your organization's goals and how you incorporate your organization's goals into actions. So organizations are not going to be judged against some mythical, like, this is what an organization needs to look like. It needs to be 50% white and 50% black. There's not that, that is not what we're going here for here. We're looking at moving organizations along a pathway to be able to identify, set their own goals, and then measure themselves according to the goals that they have set. So this is a lot more of an interactive and iterative process, and it is going to be evaluated by a team that is not made up of staff members. That this will be, SAP has been evaluated in the past by staff members, and pretty much if you check all the boxes, you get the funds. We're going to slowly be moving to portions of the application to be reviewed by external panelists. So, but it's a slow progression because we really want to be mindful of everybody who we fund, because there is going to be a seat at the table for everybody as we move forward. No one will be excluded because of the town that they live in. Or the people that they serve necessarily. So we will be talking more about that.
Very, very good point. Thank you, Liz.
Yeah, but Liz, can I just, and Rhonda, if you, before you go on, having said that though, there is a clear message that issues related to DEI is a priority going forward.
Correct, that is absolutely correct. And I think, I mean, and we can have this as a philosophical discussion anytime, but those of you who have worked with the Office of the Arts before know that in 2016, in our strategic plan, we launched our READY initiatives. So none of this should come as a surprise. Relevance, equity, access, diversity, and inclusion have been a priority for us since 2016. So none of this should hopefully come as a surprise. And I see there's a note, what does DEI mean? DEI means diversity, equity, and inclusion. It's an acronym. And I know that if there's a wish to have more discussions about that, that's something that Lisa and the Cultural Alliance have been diving deep into for the past 3 years or more. So there's lots of room at the table to have that conversation and learn more about that.
Can I ask a quick question?
Certainly,
yes.
Thank you, Liz.
Sure. Joanne?
Hi. I have a question about eligibility. We are a 501c3, but we are recently a 501c3 because we used to be under the Ridgefield Independent Film Festival, used to be under another umbrella organization. Is there a limit of, do we have to have been a 501c3 for a certain amount of time before we can apply, or is just having that status good enough?
In the past, there had been a 3-year history, and we have been slowly moving away from that. And especially for fiscal year 23, what we're about to launch, we're going to be looking at your most recently completed fiscal year. So if you're an organization, a newbie, you're going to need at least one completed fiscal year to report to us on.
So if we have that under our, because we've been around for 7 years, but if we have that from past years, but not under our own 501c3, would that count, or it has to be?
Are your finances and your fiscal agent separate, absolutely completely separate with your own 990s?
No, we've yet to file our own 990 because we've been under an umbrella. So we do have that information, but it's under a past
maybe umbrella organization.
Joanne, maybe.
Yeah, I think I need to have a conversation with you offline, okay, and just to lay all the details.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Joanne, it sounds to me, and I'm not super, you know, Rhonda may determine this differently, but it sounds to me your 990 from previous years was under your umbrella.
Yeah, they
they were filed under your umbrella organization, right? Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. So it sounds like there might be a disconnect between those filings under the umbrella, mm-hmm, and your newly formed 501c3 and that 1 year requirement. That's the way it sounds to me, but yeah. Rhonda's being very generous to give you an audience, so I would take it.
Okay, thanks. I will, thanks.
Any other questions? Okay, so yeah, I'd love to have a further conversation with you offline so you can walk me through what's going on with your newbie. I can put my email address.
Thank you for that, Rhonda. Why don't you move on to endowment just for the sake of time. I'll put Rhonda's email in the chat.
Thank you.
And I'll add everybody's email addresses in the email when I send off the video, the recording. So, you know, everyone who's here will get all of that information as well.
So the Connecticut Arts Endowment Fund is a statutory program. It's in state law. And so including the formula in which awards are calculated, there's no wiggle room whatsoever in this program because it is by state statute. The Connecticut Arts Endowment Fund is a standalone fund that the state invested in many, many years ago. It's been growing in size ever since the last time we checked last year. It was over $20 million. And in the statute, it reads that the interest earned on this fund is to be distributed to qualifying arts organizations. So what we get every year to distribute varies depending on how well the market does and where the treasurer's office has it invested. And we have a history of the funding levels on the website. So basically, it is for arts organizations who have raised over $15,000 in private contributions for two consecutive fiscal years. Now, some of you might say, wow, $15,000, that's a lot. And we agree. It used to be $25,000, but we worked with the General Assembly to have that reduced. And that conversation is still in the back of our mind to actually make it even more equitable. But as it stands right now, an arts organization does have to have raised $15,000 in private contributions for two consecutive years, and it needs to be documented on filed IRS forms, either 990s or 990 EZs. Those are the only two forms that I am able to accept in the application. The application is incredibly straightforward. It is basically basic information, upload your 990s and boom, you're done. So the next question is, well, how much can I expect from an endowment grant? And I get this question all the time, and there is simply not a straightforward answer because there are so many factors that go into the endowment, including what we have to distribute, how many applicants come in, how many applicants raise more money in second year as the first, because if you raise more money in your second year, according to the calculation, you get a bump, a little bonus. And so there's so many different things that go into the endowment that I can never tell somebody what to expect. I just kind of say, well, just leave it out of your budget and look at it as a bonus, because there's simply absolutely no way. After the fact, I'm able to share with you how your award was determined, but there's no way I can tell you what it might be before all the calculations are run. I hope that makes sense. Even though the application is really straightforward, the explaining how it all works with all the different factors is not as simple. But for that, because it's a statutory program, the deadline absolutely always is December 15th. So if you think your arts organization qualifies, put that star on that calendar, because that deadline will absolutely never change. And I think that's it. Does anybody have any questions regarding endowment?
I do.
Sure.
So we blithely went and applied for this. We'd gotten it before, and we thought that we would be all hunky-dory for this year. And it turns out that because we restricted our donations from 2020 to be used in 2021, because we essentially went into organizational coma during 2020, we didn't meet the threshold of that $15,000. So does that mean that we've got two more years now that we're ineligible because we need to show two solid years of $15,000 individual contributions?
Correct. I need two consecutive fiscal years as documented on two filed IRS forms.
Okay.
The data that we take off the 990s varies a little different if you're filing an EZ versus a full. Mm-hmm. If it's a full 990, we take data directly off the statement of revenue within your 990. If it's an EZ, I take data off of, I think it's 1, 3, and 6B off your EZ. Yeah. If you have any. And what I have also learned through the years is accountants do filings differently. I get a lot of questions from people. Well, we raised it, but our accountant put it in this line. So please talk to your accountant and please talk to me to make sure that your accountant is plugging your private contributions in the lines that are relevant to the endowment fund. It actually comes up quite often, and I always thought it was so bizarre. I always thought it was like clear cut what accountants, you know, how they file, but apparently it's not. So people, they tend to do things differently. So I'm open to that conversation to show you exactly the lines that we take off the 990 and the EZ, so you can make sure that your accountant is aware of how to properly plug in your contributions in those lines.
Yeah, I think we've learned our lesson. It was just, you know, we were trying to be ultra conservative and responsible during COVID. And therefore we restricted all this money that came in, and then we lost out on the grant because it didn't show up like that on our 990. So
all I can say is that I hope you understand that this doesn't have anything to do with us. So
yeah, we totally
are hands tied because this is the law.
Yeah.
And it's the law. We can't work around it. That's like, we can't work around the deadline, but it's only on this program. And that is something to keep in mind. And I know Scott hasn't talked about it, and we're not going to get into it, but when, you know, funding for arts and for culture and for humanities is always an interesting discussion to be having. And it's always something to pay attention to and be aware of. And there are groups out there who, like the Cultural Alliance, like the Connecticut Arts Alliance, many of them who are out there talking about these things all the time. So make your opinions about how this funding could be going to help your organizations out there heard.
Thank you.
Rhonda, you want to talk about Arts Heroes for a sec?
Oh, yes. Okay. So this is the Connecticut Arts Heroes is a recognition that the Connecticut Office of the Arts does in the arts field. It's to honor individuals. It's to honor the individuals that are kind of behind the scene or in front of the screen who are doing amazing work in the arts. So if you have a hero, somebody that you admire, someone who's done amazing work in your community, and they are just somebody that you admire and feel that they should be recognized, please think about the Connecticut Arts Hero Awards. The nomination form is going to be launched sometime in August. And we are looking forward to lots of nominations. And once the nominations come in, We share them with our DRSOs who hold panels to select heroes. We normally honor 9 individuals a year because we have 9 distinct regions in our state that are served by our designated regional service organization, of which the Cultural Alliance of Western Connecticut is one. So it's a fun event, and there's music and entertainment, and we celebrate really, really great people. So please nominate your heroes, and please think about coming to the event because it's a good one. It's fun.
And it will be held this year in January, just so you know. So.
Oh, thank you, Tamara. She's listing all of the past arts heroes. And I just wanted a fun fact. Our very first Connecticut arts hero was our very own Lou Rivera, who, for the folks on the line who do not know who she is, she has worked in the Office of the Arts for 30 plus years. It might even be 35 plus years. The historical knowledge this individual has is amazing. She's our grants administrator. And we honored her with the very first Connecticut Arts Hero Award back in 2016, I believe it is. So does everybody here know Lou Rivera? If you've gotten a grant from us, you would will. She was our very first hero. And we are very lucky to have her.
Thanks, Rhonda. Okay, I'm just gonna finish up sort of, I'm gonna ask Tamara to flip back to our funding page. And I'm just gonna mention 2 programs. Scott alluded to the Connecticut Summer at the Museums program. I think those of you who know about that program already know about that. The application for the 4 profit museums closes on June 6th, and the application for the nonprofit museums, which goes through Connecticut Humanities, closes this Friday. So if you need information about that, reach out to, for the most part, it's going to be to Scott and Lian. And then the other program I wanted to just mention that's going to be on again this year is the general operating support for theaters and performing groups. This was part of a $3 million pool that the legislature approved because they understood that theaters and performing groups were really, really hurt, especially badly by the pandemic. So it's a $3 million pool. It was disseminated last year, and the same amount of money is available this year. The application last year opened sometime in the late fall. I know we made announcements, I think, in January. So we are going to strive to have that application open a little bit earlier this year so we can move that along. We're tweaking the eligibility requirements and making sure our language is really tight. But in fact, your organization does have to be an arts organization. It does have to be a nonprofit. And it has to fall into one of 6 categories to be, to actually apply to receive these funds. And again, this is legislatively directed. So we do have to be we're a little bit more limited in the way we can interpret. We already pushed the interpretation by including performing groups because we all felt very, very, secure in saying that theaters might be able to be open, but if performing groups aren't able to sustain their performances, it won't matter if there's spaces that are open to host them because there'll be nobody to perform in the performing spaces is what I'm trying to say. So that is coming. So if that is you again, Lisa and Alice will be really good resources. And of course, we're here to help you as well. I think we've covered pretty much the grants that are going to be open for application this year. There's one other grant program we have that I'll just mention, and that is our strategic partnership grants. We have one of the things we wanted to do is to make sure that we were able to find people and partners that could help us achieve our strategic vision. Strategic partnership grants really start usually at $5,000 or $10,000, and they go up from there depending on what the organization is doing. They are generally speaking not localized. They are generally speaking looking at a region or looking at a statewide program. And they are trying to achieve the goals that we have stated in our strategic plan. And as Scott noted, the way that you would begin to have a conversation about this would be to reach out directly to me, and we would talk. And probably easiest always to get me through email and just say, hi, I'd like to talk to you about a strategic partnership grant. Tell me a little bit about your organization and what you're thinking. Unless it's really not aligned or the audience would be too small, or it doesn't look like it has potential as a pilot program, we will definitely talk to you just to see if there's a there. We only fund a limited number of these per year. They are closely aligned to our READY initiative, Relevance, Equity, Access, Diversity, and Inclusion. I will also say that we're very excited to let you know that we will have a new strategic plan that will be in place starting in September of this year. And Lisa at the Cultural Alliance and Steph at the Northwest Connecticut Cultural Council, I get sometimes the names confused. Thank you. We'll be hosting a feedback session for your joined audiences with us coming up. I think it's on the 14th of June.
It is on the 14th. And I just want to jump in, Liz, and please, please, if you are available for that conversation, you know, I continue to be impressed with CO. They're looking for your input on their strategic plan. They're inviting you to be there and to give your voice. So if you're free from this region in particular, because it's my interest is this region, and if you're from this region and you can be there, please register. It's at 4 o'clock on the 14th, and it's on the Cultural Alliance's website. So we need you there.
If for some reason that doesn't work for you, that we're having four of these, they're all virtual and we set them up regionally just because that's the way we work, but you do not have to stick with your own region. You are welcome to attend the one that works for you.
Absolutely.
So, and we have somebody who is hired to attend this session. Of course it will be recorded, but they are taking all of your comments, which we're gonna throw out some questions to you. They are gonna be taking all of your comments and providing a short report on what your recommendations are. But the questions we're gonna have for you are gonna really be directed, looking at where we really need input, but understanding that we've had this unprecedented ability to talk to all of you and to listen to you for the last 2+ years of the pandemic, and to actually get to know our constituents in a way that was not possible really beforehand. So pandemic abundance, we got to hear from you. So we have some really good ideas about what we're hearing, but we wanna make sure that the language that we use is right and representative and responsive to the needs that you guys have. So yes, so I'll second that. And then I will again, open it up to questions and questions for anybody who is here. Scott, Lian, me, Rhonda, Tamara, anything we can do to answer any questions.
Liz, while folks are gathering up their questions, I just wanted to ask, because I came on late, I'll start with the last program that you talked about, but this applies to any of the programs that have been discussed today on both the arts and humanities side. Fiscal sponsors, which programs do they apply to? Which ones do they not apply to? I'm bringing this up because fiscal sponsorship is a service that the Cultural Alliance offers. There is a vetting process. It's not it's not an automatic thing. There is a process to go through, but it is a service that if we can provide, we will take a look at. In fact, we've got one of our partners, two of our partners online now. I just wanted to ask about that because there may be other people interested.
Rhonda, do you want to take that question for endowment and SAP? Rhonda?
I don't know if Rhonda can hear. I know she was having problems hearing in the beginning.
Okay. So I don't run either one of those two programs, but I can tell you that our Arts Endowment program does not allow for fiscal sponsorships. And if you are interested in SAP, I believe we cannot accommodate fiscal sponsorships for that program either. However, under certain circumstances, we do allow for fiscal sponsorships. But that said, 3 years is the maximum number of years that we will accept an application from you with a fiscal sponsor. Some of the programs that we've had opened that came during the pandemic did not require what we were able to accept fiscal sponsors for. And I'll let Scott speak to that for Connecticut Humanities.
Sure. I don't think Rhonda can hear us still. So maybe we want to type something to her.
Yeah, for now. Yeah. She's texting me, so we're good.
Sure. So for Connecticut Humanities, for the most part, fiscal sponsorship is allowed. So if you are working on a project grant, like a quick grant or an implementation grant for an exhibition or a public programming series, and either you're an organization that for whatever reason is not able to apply to Connecticut Humanities directly, or let's say you're doing a documentary film and you're an independent filmmaker, we do allow for fiscal sponsorships to create matches between that individual or organization that can't apply and the humanities project that we want to consider. We would be making grants essentially with that third party. So if the Cultural Alliance of Western Connecticut becomes the fiscal sponsor, which they are on an implementation grant right now for a documentary film, we enter into contract with them and they manage the project and the funds on that project's behalf. Capacity grants, by and large, the answer is no. And that's because it is a grant to strengthen an organization. So we would be wanting to strengthen organizations who are able to apply to us directly. And then there's the operating support, the CT Cultural Fund operating support grants. Last year, fiscal sponsorship was allowed. We have not met to discuss eligibility this year, but based on a number of the things that happened last year with some of the fiscal sponsorships, it's highly likely that we will not be allowing fiscal sponsorships this year, but we would probably be changing some of the eligibility to be that if you are a 501c3 and have not had your status for a full year, we might be allowing organizations to apply with less than a year, which is usually a requisite for our other grant lines. So that's a long way of saying yes in some cases, no in other cases. Talk to us, we can help work you through it.
There's one more I want to add, is the sponsorship, and the sponsorship does not allow for fiscal sponsorship. So
thanks, Lian.
The three core project grants that Scott mentioned are the ones that allow for fiscal sponsorship.
The big, the Connecticut Heritage Fund does allow for fiscal sponsorship, however, right? Is that correct?
The Connecticut Humanities Fund, yes.
Humanities Fund.
The Connecticut Cultural Fund, probably not for this next coming year.
Okay. So it did for 1 year.
It did for 1 year.
Thank you for answering that question. It's you know, so important, I think, for people to hear that, particularly, I don't think we're unique in this part of the state, but there just are an enormous amount of informal, amazing organizations, but yet informal. We find that to be a lot of the case here. So I'm sure that those that are on this call and others that aren't, you know, would be interested in knowing about those opportunities.
That said, Lisa, I'll jump in and say, you know, Scott at Connecticut Humanity, I'll speak for Scott, but I'll let them speak. You know, grants that come in that feature more than one organization that are looking at big projects or looking at essentially working with smaller organizations to achieve more impact, do qualify for project grants with Connecticut Humanities. Good, they're shaking their heads because I know that it used to be that way. So.
It is a funding priority of Connecticut Humanities. We have several. One of them is partnerships and collaborations. It's not that we don't fund, and we do in many cases fund projects from organizations, doing the project work themselves, but when there's two or three or more collaborating organizations that are drawing upon their strengths, and I highlighted briefly a Ridgefield Historical Society grant for suffrage, that's a great example of collaboration. Rather than have Richfield Historical Society doing a whole bunch of suffrage programs and the library doing something else and Keeler Tavern doing something completely separate, they are doing a great job on an annual basis on several projects now of aligning all their programs and having everything be thematic across organizations. And that's something that helps meet a great priority. And then we're really helping a community explore topics together as one example.
I love that example. Richfield is a particular animal. And so in some regards, you know, collaborating is something that they are not unfamiliar with. There's not a lot, you know, other communities may be less so, but it is good for, you know, I think talent here and others to hear about those kinds of opportunities and possibilities.
Just real quick, I also want to just ask if there's any artists that have questions. I know I was moving through my my overview a little quickly, in part because I thought we were wrapping up earlier. I forgot we were going till 2. And I wanted to be thoughtful of all the other programs ahead of me, or that was going to be coming. If any artists have questions, please raise your hand. And at the same time, I also want to point that the Office of the Arts, while I know our focus today is on grants, we do offer a number of different programs and services. And one that I want to pull down, which does fall at the very bottom of the screen, under programs and services, because this all automatically goes by alphabetical order. And that's our Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts program, which is just sort of gaining speed and it's part of a new partnership. And there are opportunities for artists and arts organizations to gain pro bono legal support through this new partnership. But I also know that there was a voice in this mix with a new arts organization. We conducted 2 workshops, one which was a Legals Entity 101 for creative businesses, and one for charitable nonprofits that provided a very good overview. Both of these workshops, we still have the recordings available on our website, so these can be a resource for artists and arts organizations in your network, Lisa.
That's awesome, Tamara. Thank you.
Anybody have any questions? Any hands up?
Yeah, we're going to do a better job of getting that out. I know that's fairly new, and I know that we've talked about it a lot with our RSO network with COA. But we'll amplify that even more, and get those links out there.
I have a question.
Jonathan, go ahead.
So what exactly is the scope of the Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts? We, as a theater company, tend to have an extremely busy contracting period leading up to our rehearsals, where, you know, I could be fielding 35, 40 contracts that need to be vetted through council and everything else. We're fortunate that we have an attorney on our board who's volunteering to do this work, but the volume of work is a lot. And my sense from Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts might be that the scope is more around, you know, maybe if they're obtaining a property or if there's a lawsuit or there's some sort of big one-time project, but our needs for attorneys are really kind of ongoing.
Question.
Liz, feel free to jump in if you want to add more, but this is a new partnership that we have expanded with the Arts and Business Council of Greater Boston, and they serve as the VLA for the state of Massachusetts. It is available for art services, so both nonprofit as well as individual artists. I think a lot will depend on their own network. They are currently working to build up a network of attorneys here in Connecticut. So we're still in the baby stage of expanding and growing this program. It is a little bit more geared towards those one-time, needs. But at the same time, it doesn't hurt to just reach out to them and find out if there happens to be an attorney within their network that you may be able to tap into for more ongoing support. Like I said, it never hurts to ask, just to see where things might land. Based on the nonprofit or an individual artist and your sort of income status, you would be matched with an attorney in a pro bono capacity. So some services may be free and other services will be at a reduced cost. And in part, it's going to depend on, you know, the size of your own budget and or income. And then they do what they can to provide you with that additional support. We also are planning to do additional workshops on an ongoing basis. So that we have the two available up here, again, in an archive capacity, so you can go back and reference them, but we are in the planning stage for additional workshops this fall.
Are there any other questions? I know that we've got time, but I just want to see if there's any other questions, because if not, we can, wrap things up and leave early, which is not always a bad thing. That's free time for everybody to have. So are there any other questions regarding the presentations that have been provided today? No. Joanne?
When Scott was talking about the fiscal sponsorships, how much information about your fiscal partner, should it be 50-50? So the sponsoring organization, should that be the focus, or should the organization that they are sponsoring for the project be more the focus?
So again, for our project grants, it's really about the organization that is eligible to apply to us. So we want to know, when it comes to the organization, about the, when was that grant I was mentioning that Lisa's doing with the Cultural Alliance. It's about the Cultural Alliance. It's their board list. It's their budgets. They need to be the authorizing signatory, because we'd be entering into contract with them. And the fiscal agent at the end is the person that'll be looking at the books from the Cultural Alliance side. Everything else is about the project. And that's where we really get into the heart of that particular aspect. So it's really the project is the core. And then when we need organizational details, it's about the organization we'd be entering the contract with.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, I'm gonna let Alice wrap things up. But before she does, I just wanna quickly thank, because I got on late. So I just wanna thank Liz and Rhonda and Tamara and Scott and Lian for taking out time of your very extraordinarily busy schedules. I know how busy you are, or at least I have an inkling. I don't know every little detail, and nor do I want to. but I know that you are extraordinarily busy. And so I thank you for doing this. For those of you who don't know us, and again, I wasn't here in the intro, but I wanna make sure that you understand that we are firm, strong, and enthusiastic partners with Connecticut Office of the Arts and Connecticut Humanities. We are one of 8 designated regionals around the state. We service Western Connecticut. Our geographic area is the Greater Danbury Area footprint, although members of our organization, and we are a membership group for marketing support, spans well outside of our 10-town area. But we're here to support artists, creative entrepreneurs, arts and cultural organizations. And the way that we do that, one of the ways, is providing space for these kinds of conversations. That's how we're a partner, one of many ways that we're a partner with COA and CTH. It's providing space for these kinds of convenings and conversations to be able to allow you an opportunity to get in front of people that you need to get in front of and ask questions and to be information providers. It's just one of many ways that we support our area. There are others, so don't be surprised if you hear from Alice following this session with the recording and our spiel of all the other services that we offer, okay? Please, if you're not already on our list, get on our list, become a member, or at the very least, stay connected with us because there's a lot more. So thank you again for all of you, for your interest and your time. I hope you found it worthwhile. There will be a survey that we'll send out to everybody.
Thanks, yeah. Everybody. Thanks, Lisa. Thanks, Alice.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. And I have everyone's emails in the comments. So make sure you get those. And as Lisa said, I'll be sending out a recording with all information, you know, that everybody needs and, you know, about membership and our benefits. And I'll reiterate a lot of that because you're the engine that keeps us running and to be able to put these types of roundtables together. And I really appreciate everyone's availability that, you know, these artists and organizations can reach out to Scott and Leanne and Liz and Tamara and Rhonda with any other questions or concerns. So great job, learned a lot, and I appreciate everyone's time. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, have a great week. Bye, guys.